Director Piers Versteeg. So if you don't know Piers already, Piers has been Executive Director of CCWA since 2009, I was told, and was named by the West Australian newspaper as one of WA's 100 most influential people for his environmental advocacy and community leadership. I also wanted to mention that Piers just got back from a great camping trip in the Great Western Forest, and he's asked me to tell you that if he looks a bit like he's just gotten out of a swag, it's because he has. Thank you, Piers.
Thanks so much, Steph, and it's great to be with you all in the room for our first Environment Matters for this year. It's already April and we're only having our first Environment Matters Forum. We normally have them more regularly, but there has been an election and various other things, and the Clean State team's been going around the state engaging with communities around action on climate change and the incredible potential to create jobs through action on climate change here in Western Australia. But we need to come back now, the election's over, and we need to come back now to the reality of the situation that's facing us here with massive fossil fuel expansions. And that's what we're here to talk about this evening. So can I also acknowledge the Noongar traditional owners of this land and the Murujuga traditional owners of the Burrup Peninsula or Murujuga, the area that we're going to be speaking about. And I just wanted to take you through a little bit of background to what is really an incredible situation that we have found ourselves in. I just really want to acknowledge all of those distinguished guests in the room and also online. I can see that there's many leaders of various different groups that are part of the Conservation Council. It's really great to have you with us. And it's great to have you involved in this legal process, because it actually is going to be setting some precedents, I believe, in terms of how we administer environmental law here in Western Australia, but also whether these giant fossil fuel projects actually go ahead or not. So we've given it a dramatic title, The People versus Big Pollution. Well, that's exactly really what it is. Ruby will be with us to fill in the legal details, but I'm here to give you some of the kind of background. And in this situation, I probably don't have to remind us, but we are the people. I just wanted to take you through some of the reasons why we've commenced this litigation and some of the background to it. So this isn't working. Let me see. No. Do I press on that?
I'll just click
this one, isn't it?
Yeah.
Okay, so we're talking about Woodside and their Burrup Hub project. And the Burrup Hub project is actually an extraordinary story of Australia's most polluting fossil fuel project. It's actually a lot of different projects all joined together as part of this thing that Woodside call the Burrup Hub. They've stopped using that name a little bit because they realise it's becoming quite problematic for them, but it's certainly still something that they're committed to pursuing. And they have the AGM tomorrow. There'll be a lot of activity around that. Some of you will be hopefully joining us for that, and you'll get a different kind of insight into it. But tonight we're going to talk about the legal challenge to some of the environmental approvals. So as you know, Western Australia has very, very large gas resources that are internationally significant in their size and scale. And some of them are already being developed or have been developed, the offshore resources, principally in the Carnarvon Basin as part of the Northwest Shelf developments. And Woodside and Chevron and other companies are involved in that, as you know. But there's also very huge, even much larger onshore gas resources here in Western Australia. Up in the Kimberley, around Broome with the Canning Basin, and of course in the Perth Basin between here and Geraldton, there's gas resources as well. And the Burrup Hub is really a way to access a lot of those different resources and send them offshore for export in the form of liquefied natural gas. So it's a project to dramatically expand and lengthen the timeframe of the existing gas projects that we already have here. And we already, Australia has overtaken Qatar recently as the world's largest exporter of LNG. And most of those exports are coming from here in Western Australia. And the result of that in greenhouse gas emission terms, in terms of carbon pollution, is that Western Australia is the only state with rapidly rising pollution compared to the 2005 baseline under the Paris Agreement. This is directly as a result of the LNG projects that are producing so much pollution here in Western Australia, but also as a result of the influence that these gas companies have and their lobbying efforts on the West Australian government, suppressing action on climate change and policy to get our pollution under control in other parts of the economy. So this is the result. We've got our pollution rising. And as the Conservation Council, the peak environment group here in Western Australia, we simply can't stand by and let this happen without trying to challenge some of these projects and actually what's going on here. Because as we know, we're in a climate emergency. We need to get our emissions rapidly reducing, not increasing, as we see here. So that brings me to Woodside's Burrup Hub proposal. And as I mentioned before, the Burrup Hub is an attempt by Woodside to enable the development of some very significant new gas fields. The Scarborough gas field in the off the Northwest Shelf, the Browse Basin gas field 900 kilometres to the north of that off the Kimberley coast, and also onshore gas fields with developments like the Waitsia gas development that's recently been approved in the Perth Basin, which would also supply gas to this Burrup Hub for export as LNG. So the plan is to expand and to continue the lifetime of those existing LNG processing facilities that are on the Burrup. And they're owned and they're operated by Woodside, but they're owned by a series of different joint ventures that involve Chevron, BHP, Shell, BP, and others as well. So they're quite complex commercial arrangements that relate to the various different aspects of this Burrup Hub development. When we looked at the overall greenhouse gas emissions that would come from this Burrup Hub, we were absolutely staggered because when you add it all up, we came to the figure of about 6 gigatons or 6 billion tons of greenhouse gas emissions that would be released over the lifetime of these projects. And independently, Climate Analytics, we commissioned a report from Climate Analytics, which is a Berlin-based consultancy and think tank that does work around climate change. They came up with very, very similar figures. So we were confident that we were pretty much on the money, even though when we released this, Woodside said that it was wrong. So, but just in terms of what that works out to, it makes it Australia's most polluting fossil fuel project ever proposed. It is about four times the emissions of the Adani coal mine proposed in Queensland. And it's equivalent to around about 35 coal-fired power stations running every year from now until 2070. So, you know, we've seen the response in other parts of the world and other parts of Australia when there's proposals to build just one new coal-fired power station. Of course, that shouldn't happen. Well, this project is equivalent to 35 new coal-fired power stations. And a significant amount of that pollution would occur here in Western Australia, but a much larger part would actually occur elsewhere. It's called scope 3 emissions when we export that gas and when it's burnt in other places. So this means that this is a project which we simply cannot ignore. As civil society organisations that are concerned about climate change, as anyone who is concerned about climate change and the future of life on this planet, we cannot ignore a project of this size and scale. And so we've been engaging in various ways with shareholders, with the government, and in various different ways to try and constrain, prevent, and stop these Burrup Hub developments. It's not just the overall emissions from this project that is a worry, but the emissions intensity. That means the amount of emissions that is produced per unit of energy that's created. And of all the gas projects around the world, we want to see that the only ones, if there is going to be further gas expansion, we say that it's not necessary, but if there is going to be further gas expansion, it should be the cleanest gas that you can get. But the Burrup Hub is actually the opposite. It's actually the dirtiest gas because there's huge amounts of CO2 that are entrained in those gas fields. They have to pipe it really long distances. The age of the infrastructure in the North West Shelf facility in particular means that it's very inefficient. So we're talking about some of the dirtiest and highest polluting gas in the world. There's also really serious impacts that would occur on the marine environment. This slide looks at the Scott Reef and the Browse Basin. Part of it involves drilling 50 odd gas wells in and around the Scott Reef, which is an incredibly biodiverse part of the marine ecosystem off the Kimberley coast there, very remote, with incredible species diversity. It's got its own species, unique species of marine turtle that depends on that area. And Woodside want to drill 50 wells in and around that reef system to extract the gas from underneath it. But the Scarborough development would also have really significant impacts on the marine environment. And we've been working with experts called OceanWise to understand that and bring that to the attention of the decision makers as part of the environmental assessment processes. We have the Friends of Australian Rock Art here, who are here because these projects are also having a devastating impact on this incredible Aboriginal heritage that exists on the Burrup Peninsula. It's now proposed for World Heritage listing, over a million unique rock carvings in this incredible landscape. Thousands of these rock carvings were already destroyed to make way for those LNG plants. But what's happening now is the acid gas emissions from those plants is causing erosion of the surface of those rocks and having an impact on that incredible Aboriginal heritage. The state government has, and acid levels on the surface of the rocks are 1,000 times higher now than before industry. And the state government has commissioned an extensive study to examine this impact. But in the meantime, Woodside are proposing to go ahead and extend and exacerbate this damage. By the way, Woodside don't have Section 18 approvals under the Aboriginal Heritage Act to cause impact to this incredible Aboriginal heritage, unlike Rio Tinto did when they destroyed Juukan Gorge. But in a very similar situation, the traditional owners, the Murujuga, are themselves subject to gag clauses that prevent them from speaking out publicly about this. So it's got some very similar parallels to the Juukan Gorge situation. This is an example of Woodside's greenwash. It's not very nice shade of green, really. It's not really very attractive, but really they're trying to say that they're doing the right thing by the climate. They're going to offset all of their CO2. Gas is a wonderful transition fuel that's replacing coal and, you know, helping on the global fight for climate change. And they're planting all these trees. They're going to become more energy efficient. And by the way, they're doing a little bit of hydrogen and other things on the side. Really, it is just greenwash. And when we go through it, I'm just going to take you through some of the elements of this, because I'm sure you will be pretty surprised and pretty disappointed by the reality that sits behind some of this. But before we do that, here's a picture of the guy that wants to be Australia's next Prime Minister, who was just up visiting Woodside on the Burrup earlier this week, or late last week, I think it was. And I just wanted to draw attention to a couple of the comments he made on this Facebook post. First, he says, they're visiting Woodside near Karratha, and he's got this nice green hat on, so he's obviously fallen for the greenwash there. He's saying that this site alone produces 1% of Australia's GDP. Well, okay, that might be right, but they're certainly not paying 1% of Australia's tax. This company and this industry in general pay almost no tax. And in fact, what they do is they leave the Australian taxpayer with this giant bill for cleaning up the crap that they leave. And we've seen that with Woodside just recently. And there's been a whole inquiry into the state and Commonwealth governments having to pay the remediation costs of Woodside's abandoned infrastructure that's now going to cost hundreds of millions of dollars to the Australian taxpayer. So yes, they might be producing 1% of Australia's GDP, but most of that is going into the pockets of people like Peter Coleman, the CEO, and the Woodside shareholders, and there's very little return or revenue back to the Australian people. He also says that they're powering thousands of jobs. Well, actually, the gas industry, when you look at it, by comparison to other sectors, is the smallest employer in Western Australia. And per $1 million of invested in any industry, the gas industry produces fewer jobs than any other industry. Renewable energy produces 8 to 10 jobs per $1 million of investment. The gas industry produces far less than 1 job per $1 million of investment. So he's a bit wrong on that count as well. And then here's the cracker. Woodside is committed to reaching net zero emissions by 2050. Okay, well, I'm going to take you through some of the reasons why that statement really needs to be called into question, especially when this company are trying to develop the world, Australia's most polluting fossil fuel project. Here are some examples of Woodside's double speak. They say one thing to shareholders to try and attract the investment, and they say a very different thing to governments and regulators and to the general public. So what do they say about carbon pricing? Well, they say the Burrup Hub projects, they're economically viable at a carbon price of $80 a tonne. That's what they say to shareholders. Don't worry, doesn't matter if a carbon price comes in, these projects are going to be viable or still profitable. But what they say to regulators, if you put requirements on us to offset our emissions at $5 a tonne or less, it's going to risk billions of dollars of investment. So they're running a campaign to try and prevent having any controls on their emissions on one hand, whilst at the same time telling shareholders, don't worry, it's profitable at a carbon price of $80 a tonne. They also say that they're committed to implementing carbon capture and storage for the Browse Basin, and that won't affect the profitability of the project. Well, we've seen how well that's gone with Chevron, haven't we? So they say on one hand to the shareholders, yep, we can go ahead with it, it's going to be fine. But then to the regulator, they say, well, carbon capture and storage isn't technically or commercially viable for the Browse Basin, so don't make us do it. What about what they say about the Paris Agreement and temperature goals? Well, their website today, I checked, says we support the Paris Agreement and its goal to limit the rise in global temperature to well below 2 degrees. Their own documents submitted to the Commonwealth government say that the market demand assumptions that they're making for LNG are based on the 2019 IEA stated policy scenario. Well, that policy scenario is aligned with a 3 to 4 degree temperature rise. And that's the only way they're going to be able to sell this LNG is if the world doesn't decarbonize, doesn't move away from fossil fuels, and the result of that will be 3 to 4 degrees warming, not 2 degrees. It'll be catastrophic. What about their carbon targets? They've recently announced some new carbon targets. They sound kind of okay, 15% reduction by 2025, 30% reduction by 2030. And that one that we saw from Albo, net zero emissions by 2050. Well, when you dig into the detail, it's rubbish. Woodside's targets actually are applied to a small proportion of the overall emissions that they're responsible for under Australian law. It's a bit like me saying, well, I'm going to have a target of losing weight, but I'm only going to apply the target to my foot. It really doesn't make sense. So when you actually look at the numbers, what their targets mean, they translate into only a 32% reduction by 2050, not net zero, and only a 9.5% reduction by 2030. Now that's far less than even the Australian government has set as a target for the Australian country as a whole under the Paris Agreement. And as you know, the Australian government are under pressure to increase that target. So they're well behind in terms of what their targets actually mean. But the thing is, it gets worse because they don't intend to meet their targets by actually reducing their emissions. They intend to meet these targets by buying cheap offsets. They won't tell us where they're buying their offsets from. We think they're coming from India and other places. They won't tell us how much they're spending on their offsets or whether they're certified under any particular standard. But when you actually look back at their website, you can see that what will actually happen to their emissions, their absolute emissions is that they're going to go up. They're not going to go down, and they're going to go up really significantly. They're going to go up by 65% here in Australia, according to their own numbers. And globally, including the scope three emissions, they're going to go up by those scope three emissions, which are much larger, are going to go up also by 25%. So their real emissions are going to go up while they're claiming that they're going to meet net zero emissions by 2050. So they're one of the organizations and some governments out there that are using these targets of net zero by 2050 as a way to actually facilitate increasing pollution and increasing fossil fuel production. We can't let them get away with this. This is from their own website, in case you think I'm making these numbers up. It shows that their pollution is going to increase from the Burrup Hub from a current total of about 9.6 million tonnes per annum to 15.9 million tonnes per annum. Their graphs look very similar to the graphs that we produced 18 months ago. And when we released these graphs 18 months ago, they said that our numbers were wrong. Well, it's taken them 18 months to work out that our numbers were right. And this is what they're proposing to do. So their targets are saying one thing, and their website is saying a completely different thing. This is what they're saying will increase in terms of the scope three emissions. So what is Woodside's strategy to manage its carbon risks? I'll tell you what it is. It's political donations, it's lobbying, it's blocking action on climate change by government. And this one company is the single greatest impediment to real action on climate change in Western Australia, because to protect its own commercial interests, it's stopping policy from being put in place in Western Australia that would see our emissions go down across a number of sectors. This is some examples of the lobbying that they do on the front page of the West Australian, bullying governments and the independent EPA into having climate policies which allow them to get away with this increased pollution and don't put any scrutiny or controls on their emissions. So this is how this company does business. And we need to be aware of that as West Australians, and we've got a responsibility to stand up for it, because that is the result. That is the result. And that result is a disaster for future generations. It's a disaster right now. We've seen cyclones, we've seen bushfires just in the last few months that are already devastating our ecosystems and our communities. So we can't let them get away with it. So to come back to the Burrup Hub, to come back to this picture, each of the elements of the Burrup Hub that you can see in this picture are being assessed or approved without assessment in some cases, each in their individual merits. There's no assessment, and this is an extraordinary thing about this project, there's no overall environmental assessment that looks at the whole thing and its overall cumulative environmental impacts. So each of the elements looks, you know, relatively smaller. And Woodside have deliberately done this. They've broken up this huge $50 billion mega project into all of these little elements that are on different timelines. And it's very difficult as a community or even the EPA with the resources they've got to understand what the overall impact of this actually means. So that means that there's this extraordinary situation with the most polluting fossil fuel project ever to be proposed in Australia, broken into all these individual pieces, each assessed individually, no assessment of cumulative impact. And we started to notice some things that were pretty problematic about this, because we've been following each of these assessment processes, and some of you have made submissions into them. Thousands of submissions were made. And we've noticed some anomalies. Back in 2019, the EPA had quietly given approvals by extending the existing approvals that Woodside have without any environmental impact assessment, without any consultation, without any community consultation, didn't consult the traditional owners, didn't consult anybody to allow elements of the Burrup Hub to proceed. And these elements are not some of the smaller elements. They're the parts of it that actually have the some of the greatest environmental impacts, because it's where all the pollution comes from. It's the parts that process the gas. And of course, that's polluting the climate, but it's also causing impact on the rock art. So when we noticed this, we referred these approvals, if you like, back to the EPA under their statutory process and said, hang on, you need to assess these, you need to assess these projects under the Act. That's what you're required to do. And we're referring it to you. So we did that. And the EPA took, I don't know, about 9 months to work out what the hell to do about it before they realized they had to actually respond to our referrals, because there's a statutory process to do that. And so they felt they had to go back and consult Woodside. So they did that, they consulted Woodside. Woodside resisted the attempt to assess their projects, of course. And then the EPA finally, after, I don't know, maybe a year, came back and advised us that they actually didn't have the power. Extraordinary. The EPA is saying they don't have the power under state legislation to assess these projects without Woodside's permission. Extraordinary. But it gets worse, because then they said, well, the only thing you can do about this is go and get the matter resolved by a court. So here we are having to go to a court to go to the expense of getting lawyers and all those sorts of things. And luckily we've got the Environmental Defenders Office to help us, and take the risk that if we're unsuccessful in these court proceedings, we could face hundreds of thousands of dollars in costs, court costs, not just to pay our own court costs, but to pay the costs of the respondent, which, by the way, is not just the state government, but Woodside, who've joined the case. So that's why we've asked for support from the community, because it's really important, and as a matter of justice in Western Australia, that to allow this kind of legal action, we need support and the financial capability to actually make these challenges. So that leads me to the point that we are now. And late last year, we did commence this action in the Supreme Court. And it's going to be ongoing for some time. I don't know how long it's going to last. Maybe Ruby will have some insight into that. But I think it's going to drag on for some time. And during that time, it's quite uncertain for Woodside and its shareholders about whether they should be going ahead with these projects or not. But that's not our fault. That's the process that the court is going to take. But I just wanted to finish by saying that the legal action isn't the only thing going on around the Burrup Hub and the attempts to prevent this development. The campaign's actually growing extraordinarily now. And just in the last few days, we've seen both Greenpeace and the Australian Marine Conservation Society join the campaign. Over 6,000 of their supporters have emailed Woodside Board telling them to drop the project. Some of you might be, some of those people have sent emails. IEFA, who's an independent energy and economics analyst, have released a report questioning the business case. Apparently this mic's died, and this one, is this one? Okay. I don't really need a mic, but maybe the people online. Seamless. Extraordinary. Woodside CEO has resigned, and the shareholders have called on the board to ensure that the new CEO, whoever that is, has got the freedom to review the Burrup Hub developments. They're not just going to be locked into having to implement them. And shareholder resolutions have been tabled at Woodside's AGM tomorrow, asking the company to wind down its fossil fuel operations and return the capital to shareholders. The first time these kinds of resolutions have been put forward to a company like this. So this is just in the last few days. And there's a whole range of different organizations now. When we started this work, when we started this research and published this report 18 months ago, the Conservation Council was the only organization looking at gas in WA. Well, that is not the case anymore. All sorts of organisations are now joining with us, and many of which aren't displayed here, including Friends of Australian Rock Art, because I couldn't find a good logo for them on the website. But thanks for being with us here, Judith. So I just wanted to say that this campaign is growing, it's building momentum. We don't know what's going to happen with the court case. It's highly uncertain what the outcome of that's going to be. And we've seen in other situations where, you know, there's been successful legal action and then governments just got around that in some way. So we can't afford just to rely on that. There's a whole range of other things that are being implemented now, including engaging in particular with the shareholders and investors to bring to their attention the really significant financial risks around these projects. And I think that's something that they're becoming very receptive to in the conversations that we've been having. So, and I just wanted to end on this picture. Does anyone know where that picture was taken? James Price Point. So we've been through all this before. Woodside attempted to develop a $30 billion giant gas hub at James Price Point. There was a huge community campaign with traditional owners and environmental groups, and it was eventually stopped through litigation because the environmental approvals were found invalid by the court. So we've been here before. Woodside lost a lot of capital and its shareholders lost a lot of capital over James Price Point. I was involved at the time in the campaign. You'd think they would have learned their lesson, wouldn't you? Well, let's see if they have. So that's the end of my comments, and you'll be able to ask questions afterwards, so you don't need to waste any more time now, but I'll hand back to Steph and she can introduce Ruby. Thanks.
Thank you so much, Piers, again. And so now we'll be welcoming up to the stage our next speakers. So Ruby Hamilton from the Environmental Defenders Office. So while Ruby's coming up, I've got a bit of information about Ruby. So Ruby's been at the EDO since being a law graduate and was admitted to practice in December 2018. Ruby's work as a solicitor at the EDO has comprised advice and representation on a broad range of matters, including litigation and merits appeals on environmental issues in WA, such as uranium mining, forestry, and greenhouse gas emissions. So Ruby also has a beautiful greyhound called Cleo, which some of you may have seen earlier today. Devastatingly can't be with us for the presentation, but hopefully Ruby's presentation will make up. So please join me in welcoming Ruby.
So this is the next phase of the night. I am sorry that to bring down Piers is very exciting, the people versus pollution, but really the case is the Conservation Council of WA Incorporated and the EPA chairman at Woodside. So that's the correct name for it, but I'll let you go out there and call it the people versus big pollution, because that's what we're here for. Tim McNay is the principal solicitor, or the managing lawyer of the WA program at the Environmental Defenders Office, but he couldn't be here tonight. So he sends his apologies and a few interesting points about the litigation, which I will get into myself. Firstly, I want to acknowledge the traditional owners of the Whadjuk Noongar people of the land on which we're here today. And also acknowledge them on behalf of the Environmental Defenders Office. There's just a quick intro slide sort of what the Environmental Defenders Office is for those who aren't so familiar with us, although I think a lot of people in this room probably will be. Hopefully we have helped you in some way at some point. But we're a non-profit community legal centre specialising in public interest environmental law. We have offices across the country. Now that we're a national firm, those are our sort of six streams. You can't really see them probably, but if you go on our website, you can read more about us. I don't have to bore you with it right now. And I'm a solicitor in the Safe Climate Gas and Corporate team at the EDO. And yes, I've been here since I was a law grad, and I can thank Alex Gardner for that, who is here today. He was my environmental law professor and told me about the EDO, and here I am years later. The people versus pollution. Okay, so we're here, as you know, about the Burrup Pub, which Piers has taken us through in very exciting detail. But here's, you know, Woodside's diagram of what they want to do, and that's a bit, it's a bit much. So let's break it down. These are the two processing facilities that are currently operational on the Burrup Peninsula, the Pluto LNG gas plant and the Karratha gas plant, which processes gas from the Northwest Shelf. Those are the existing gas fields that are currently being processed at those facilities. So those are the reserve sources for those facilities. Their expansion plans, though, that Woodside has, are to process a lot of new gas. And the Burrup Hub includes both Browse, so that's the offshore gas field on that side, and then Scarborough as well. And they plan on processing them at these two existing gas processing facilities, at which they also plan to process a lot of other indefinite gas, including Waitsia, any onshore fracked gas, anything that someone might seek to toll through there. So those are their plans. But essentially, this case revolves around the approvals for these two proposals. These two proposals are really what's in issue here. And these are the decisions that are being challenged before the Supreme Court. So they're decisions under the Environmental Protection Act, under Part 4, which is the assessment and authorisation of what's called proposals. So those two onshore gas processing facilities are each a proposal under the EP Act. So we have the Pluto proposal, that's its approval document. And it has a little summary of the proposal, but the proposal is the construction of facilities for the development of the Pluto gas field. Also includes the operation of those facilities, presumably, but the drafting on these documents is not always clear. And then we have the Karratha gas plant proposal, and that's its little summary there. So the decisions that are being challenged relate to these two individual proposals. A proposal is not these documents. It's not an approval per se. It's actually a real world project at any given point in time. So these are sort of the technicalities that are part of the legal case. And, you know, I'm sure they're very boring, but I'm hoping that you can go out there and impress everyone with your technical legal knowledge of these cases. And the actual decisions about those two proposals is the deletion of the specification of a particular gas field and adding new reserve sources. So you can see there for the Pluto development, they've just put a nice line through Pluto gas field. So it's now just gas field. So that means they can process Scarborough there, they can process Browse, they can go on shore and find some gas, process it there. So that's now what they propose that the Pluto proposal should be. And there's the same for the Karratha gas plant. So right there next to the reserve source where it stipulates which gas fields, just adding gas received through onshore receipt points and tie-ins. So again, any gas that you can find. So this is the section under which those changes are made. These are the approvals that we're challenging essentially. It's quite a niche section, let's say. 45C doesn't come up a lot. It's probably not something that gets in the news. And that's because this provision is, there's not a lot of transparency. There's not a lot of assessment. The public doesn't get involved in it. It's kind of tucked away in Part 4. So it essentially means that after a proposal, so after the Pluto proposal or the Karratha gas plant proposal, has been assessed and approved in the normal way, changes can be made to that. And the changes can be made by the minister, or in this case, it was a delegated decision, but the decision maker is able to approve of a change to the proposal, so a change to the project, without a revised proposal being referred to the EPA to go through that assessment and approval process again. And the way that you decide whether it can go through that process is there in subsection 2. So it's only if the minister considers, or the decision maker considers, that the change might
the change will not have a significant detrimental effect on the environment in addition to or different from the effect of the original proposal. So they have a very specific process to go through to decide whether it's appropriate that a change to a project out there in the real world that's going to have environmental, detrimental environmental effects is able to go through a little 45C process and a sign-off, or whether it's going to have to go all the way back to the referral and that process, which is what the Conservation Council had attempted to do for these changes, which they thought seemed quite significant. So this case challenges two decisions that were made under Section 45C in 2019 through judicial review, which is an application to the court, and the court is able to determine whether the decision has been made lawfully or unlawfully. So we don't get to put on a lot of, you know, interesting evidence about climate change and the different types of emissions and those sorts of things and the rock art and all these other really important aspects and the traditional owners up there. It really is just about this subsection, but hopefully that little subsection can have a big impact. So the grounds are the arguments you make in your challenge. So the case at a simple level is a challenge to the Burrup Hub proposal. So that's how it gets reported. But really, it's this is how our managing lawyer has described it. It's about whether the decision maker applied the correct test in deciding whether the changes might have environmental impacts that required further or full standard assessment. So what we will need to show is that that little test in subsection 2 of 45C was not properly gone through by the decision maker, and that they did not properly ask whether they actually had the power to approve the changes in that way. So a bit more about these grounds. Keep section 45C up there. Let's all remember section 45C. The first ground is, again, quite a technical legal ground. It's about personal consideration. So you can see there in the subsection, it's the minister, so the decision maker has to. The night's gone. Okay. So the minister is the person who's tasked with making this decision, and that's important under legislation who they've reposed a certain power in. So the parliament has decided that the appropriate person to make this decision is high up, is going to be the minister. That's the highest person who can make a decision. And then it has to be them forming the opinion that they consider these changes are fine. They're not going to result in anything major. In fact, in the parliamentary debates about this subsection when it was being put in, it was about improving proposals. So where you could change a project that was operating in the real world and you could make it better, technically you would have had to get a legal approval to change it to make it better. This section was meant to be that the minister can sign off on those sorts of changes. It's fair to say that people have found some loopholes with that. But what we argue under this ground, it's known as a jurisdictional error or jurisdictional fact ground of review. So government powers are conferred on a particular basis and can require particular processes. As I was explaining, this one is that it's the minister who must form this opinion. So in this case, there was a lawful delegation to the chairman of the EPA. But it's still that person who personally has to make this decision. And the decision documents that we obtained through Freedom of Information seem to show that hadn't quite been considered for these decisions. So it's primarily an assessment that's made by the department. They do up a table, they put the information in, and they make some recommendations at the end of their briefing to the minister, to the EPA chairman in this case. And those recommendations were that the decision maker note the assessment and sign the letter that told Woodside the changes had been approved. So we would argue that the decision maker essentially needs to go through a more stringent process of satisfying themselves that this power is appropriate for the circumstances before it can be then exercised. So that's the first ground. It's not particularly glamorous, but we think it's important. The second ground is about the standard of certainty. So again, this is a pretty big decision to allow a change to a project that's happening in the real world to go ahead without being assessed through the general process that is applied. And so it's only exercisable if that decision maker, it's not exercisable if the decision maker even considers that the change might have a significant additional or different detrimental impact. So that's a very high bar. So if there's any reasonable possibility, go ahead, carrying on. Are we back on? Yeah, that sounds good. If there's any reasonable possibility that the proposed change might have this impact, then they're completely barred from making the decision. So it's meant to be a really high test, because the whole process provided for of assessment and public participation, all those sorts of things, is really important in the Environmental Protection Act. So the question here was whether the changes to those facilities to allow them to process gas that was beyond the original gas fields might have significantly additional or different impacts. And I think from just a common sense perspective, you can see why that might set some people thinking that there's been an issue here. We looked at the decision documents obtained through FOI, and we saw that perhaps that stringency hadn't been applied again. There was a bit of messy language, and I'm sure you can put that down to, you know, what's the difference really between the word might and the word may? Well, it's pretty important if you're considering on a scientific basis what's going to happen to the environment. So in the decision documents, there's even the word unlikely used. That's an interesting assessment to make of a proposal and its environmental impacts, without any sort of public participation, without a full report from the EPA. That's one person deciding it doesn't seem likely to them. So that's our second ground of review, is that standard of certainty was not properly applied. Now the third ground, this one only applies to the Pluto challenge, but don't worry about that too much. It's more of a technicality. So this ground is about the assessment of the effects of the original proposal. So it requires a factual understanding of that original proposal that's out there operating in the real world, as we say. It's pumping out greenhouse gas emissions. It's pumping out LNG that's being shipped off. And it's about the implementation in fact of a proposal over time. So the decision documents dealing with this part of the assessment, in their nice little table of the assessment, it's more of a copy and paste of the EPA report from 2006 into this proposal. It doesn't go out and obtain other information from how the Pluto proposal has been operating and been pumping out this gas. So we argue that to properly determine the effects of the original proposal, the decision maker had to look at the project in the real world sense, the amount of greenhouse gas emissions that had actually occurred and were associated with the development of one gas field as opposed to any for any amount of time. And those are the grounds, those three right there. So we argue that all of those taken together show that the decisions are legally invalid, that the decision maker didn't have the power to sign off on these changes to the proposals that could allow the facilities to process all of this additional gas for an indefinite amount of time without a proper full assessment. So those decisions would be quashed. The 45C changes would be quashed if that was successful. That wouldn't necessarily prevent Burrup Hub in one go. It would just ensure that the proper processes are followed before those expansion activities are allowed to occur. And sure that everyone would agree that they would like to have their say in whether those changes are allowed to go forward. And these processes, we think, are really important. They're about public participation, scientific scrutiny, independent advice, and transparency. And that's that's really the essence of the Environmental Protection Act, which supposedly confers this power. But the case, of course, is also part of the growing body of climate litigation, and that's a bit more fun. So there's a quick little summary to sort of expand the scope of. So of course, this case is about the Burrup Hub, and it's extremely important in that sense. But it's also part of this growing body of climate litigation. So here's just a quick overview of the development of climate litigation. So it goes from traditional areas of administrative law. So that's the merits review and judicial review of government decisions. So whether government decisions are correct or are legally valid. And that's cases like the Adani challenges. So about, if you remember them, I'm sure everyone does, about, you know, the Yakka skink and whether everything was properly considered and before the decision maker when they made that decision. Of course, it also had climate implications because they're big fossil fuel developments. And then we saw in Gloucester Resources, which is the Rocky Hill decision coming out of New South Wales very recently, that was a really strong decision in the merits jurisdiction. So the whether that was the best decision. And that case did find that the greenhouse gas emissions from that proposed coal project were not the best decision to approve. So those are the traditional areas. Then the emerging areas that are kind of coming out now as people get a bit more creative are torts law. So that's, you know, claims against governments or companies for negligence and nuisance. So an example of that is the very recent case of Sharma. So this is the class action of all the youth plaintiffs who are taking the environment minister to court, arguing that she's going to breach her duty of care if she approves the Vickery Coal extension project. So that is a negligence duty of care type case that's just been heard a few weeks ago in the federal court. And then we have corporate law. So that's claims against, you know, corporations or under the Corporations Act or similar legislation about things like this one, McVie and Rest, was a superannuation case that was also in the news about whether that superannuation fund was adequately disclosing and managing its climate risk. So what it was investing in and those sorts of things, which settled out of court, unfortunately. But we still have another very interesting one, this one, O'Donnell and Commonwealth. So this is about government bonds, and this university student is taking the Commonwealth government to court because she's invested in government bonds and she's worried that her investment isn't being properly taken care of due to mismanagement of climate risk. So as you can see, these are very interesting areas of law. Our case fits in the traditional area, which is still important, and especially in jurisdictions like Western Australia, where we don't have a lot of opportunities to bring cases before merits review tribunals and the courts. It's a really important role in the climate litigation space to continue to hold governments to account and companies to account for their environmental approvals and their impacts on the environment, even in the more traditional sense. So there's a lot going on, and there's a lot more to come. And I'm sure if you watch out, EDO will be involved in a lot of it, and the Conservation Council as well. And I hope that you can all be as well. So thank you.